Excellent. Well, let's move straight on to our first panel, Connected Justice, a Single System. How can digital technology underpin a criminal justice system that works in genuine collaboration? That is our subject for the next hour or so. And I think we have an absolutely excellent panel to discuss it. Please come up, everyone. Bryan, Katy, and Paul, please. There we are. And I'll just introduce our panel as they are as they're coming up. Katy Bourne is the Police and Crime Commissioner for Sussex and chair of the Sussex Criminal Justice Board. Bryan Clark is the Director of Digital and Change at the National Offender Management Service. Paul Whittaker, CBE, is the Common Platform Transformation Director at the Crown Prosecution Service. Common Platform is such an important idea, I think, for making progress in this area. And Jason Hall, of course, we've just met. So I'm going to ask each of our speakers to come up to the lectern, I think, to sort of take advantage of this excellent stage. I'm going to ask each of you to speak for 5, 6, 7 minutes each, please, just so that we've got plenty of time for discussion. As I say, please everyone, prepare your questions, tweet like mad, and then we'll get into the discussion. So we'll go in the order in the programme. So Bryan Clark, would you like to come up and give us our first presentation?
Good morning. My name is Bryan Clark, and I've been a civil servant for 2 years now. So it's really quite astonishing to be talking on such an important topic here this morning. I have spent 30 years in the technology industry, and I'm hopefully being able to bring some of those learnings to the job that I have. Lord Leveson's report really highlights three technical challenges that we face in reforming the criminal justice system. I think the first two, centering on sharing data and systems that are interoperable, are in themselves quite difficult things to get right. However, I do think we can be confident that that's a possibility. The answer really is quite simply the World Wide Web, and using normal technology today, it's an entirely addressable issue. I think the third area that he highlights, which is to do with joining processes up across the system, is a much more challenging task, and it's certainly one that is attracting a great deal of, I think, everyone on the panel's attention today. I just want to give you a very simple idea that the idea of a minimum viable product is an extremely powerful one. The process that people can work through to define new processes, you know, starting with the journeys that people make through the system and learning by talking to people that are working in the system is an absolute prerequisite. The bit that I think we often forget is in defining a minimum viable product within such a large and sprawling and I might say magnificent criminal justice system is to get the scale right from where you should start, to get the point of departure correct. And I just think it's just very interesting today, Katy working so hard in the video conferencing space. Quite clearly, that's an important technology. But by working together in an area where we can get some traction, we can make progress. We can have the courage to innovate, and we can grow from there to join up with much larger initiatives. We're certainly seeing exactly the same thing in the work that we're doing in prisons, where quite recently we've gone online with two prisons, one a brand new prison in North Wales and the other a very challenging prison in Norfolk, where we've installed technology to directly support prisoners in their cells. And we're, you know, simple things having quite a remarkable impact. You know, for example, you know, working with BT, we've put telephones in the prisoners' cells, and we've halved the tariff, and the impact has been quite extraordinary. It's a concession to BT, but we've seen price volume elasticity in action. As we've halved the tariff, we've seen the volume more than double. So they're actually better off as a result of that change. But the prisoners are too. We've seen call volumes to family and supporters, and in particular to the Samaritans, just really take off. And I can say, and it's a plain fact, that in the first 4 months of operation, we saw self-harm in that prison drop every month. And at the end of last month, it was half what it was at the start of that process. And that's just one simple example of starting in a tractable way to get the minimum viable product and then build out from there. And I think that's my message this morning.
But right, thank you. Bryan, thank you very much indeed. Paul Whittaker, please.
Andrew, and good morning, everyone. I'm just going to say a few words from the Common Platform perspective, say a little bit about the Common Platform, but also share with you some of my thoughts about some of the challenges that we face here, and pick up a bit of Bryan's point about the challenges around a minimum viable product. But I'd just like to make some general comments first about the CJS as it is today. It's still largely based on a 19th century process. A lot of changes have been made and some digitization has occurred, but fundamentally it's still a 19th century process. And until very, very recently, the same court-based process was applied to the most simple, straightforward cases as it was to the most complex and serious cases. That's beginning to change with the introduction of the single justice procedure, but until very, very recently that's been the case. And though the digitization has occurred across the CJS, it's largely been unmanaged. And by that I mean it's been driven by individual agencies or indeed just individual police forces, in particular locations, and it hasn't been coordinated and managed together as a complete move forward. And that has left us with some considerable challenges now trying to consolidate that. And so what we've seen is the digitization has simply resulted in email and disks replacing paper files. So we haven't really digitized the system. We're not transferring data around in the most efficient way that we can. We're not sharing it in the most efficient way that we can. And those of you who follow the HMIC reports will have noticed the one published just before Christmas, which noted that the police are currently swamped by digital material. And indeed, I saw something on the BBC website this morning about the huge challenges being faced in trying to manage evidence and material held on offenders' computers and the huge delays that's causing. But one thing I think is clear that we do all recognise now, and that is that we all share one joint aim, and that is to harness all the benefits of digital for all the people working in the system and indeed the public, to create a fairer and more effective criminal justice system. So what's the Common Platform Programme? It's a collaboration between the CPS and the court service with the police, and it's part of the court reform programme. It's essentially the criminal arm of the court reform programme. And it aims to deliver a single cross-CJS data store and suite of services based on user needs that unify and transform the criminal process. And that is about very much about transforming the business process itself. It's getting away from the 19th century business process rather than just digitizing that particular process. And we aim eventually to deliver a fully streamlined, automated, and wherever possible, online CJS process. A number of products have been delivered already and are in use. I'm not going to dwell on those, but just say a little bit about the two principal products that the programme is working on. Core criminal case management will support all the Crown Court casework and the most serious cases in the Magistrates Court. And automated track case management will fully digitise the single justice procedure. ATCM, as we call it, is due to go live imminently. We expect that to be next week. It has the capability of taking 850,000 cases a year out of the Magistrates Court and putting them fully onto an online process. It will start with Transport for London and then be expanded out through television licence prosecutions, DVLA, and then to the police summary traffic prosecutions. It will provide an online process for all summary non-imprisonable cases. And in doing that, it will not only transform the business process for those cases, it will transform the experience for the citizen, who will be able to engage in a fully online process, but it will also transform the court estate and enable significant elements of the whole reform programme to be driven forward. So the work that we're doing will provide direct access to all court users, to all the material required to finalise criminal cases. That's the prosecution, the court, the judiciary, the defence, NOMS, and in due course, the citizen. It's a significant change and will introduce online processes for Crown Court cases, including online plea capability, online allocation of cases between magistrates' courts and Crown Court, and online case management. So it will facilitate the process of virtual hearings and taking cases out of the court, the current court procedure, to process those cases. This is a huge challenge for the programme. And we need to work and are working very closely with the police, with the Digital First programme. We're working with them to ensure that the digital case file is fully developed to provide the modern means of providing the information the criminal justice system requires, and to provide direct system-to-system automated access to multimedia material held in police digital repositories, to get away from the current hugely onerous process of transferring that material onto disks, passing disks around, which is costing millions of pounds a year. At a conservative estimate, some recent work we did suggested it was over £40 million a year, the cost of just managing it in that process. And of course, as part of that, we will rework the current manual of guidance as a digital business standard. So I just want to conclude by saying a little bit about the challenges that we face. And one of the challenges, I think, to pick up Brian's comment, is how do you develop an effective, workable MVP that is going live into a system dealing with criminal cases on a day-to-day basis that has to work and has to provide the range of capability to allow the professional users to be able to carry out their job without having to toggle between systems. That's a big challenge and one we are facing at the moment in preparing to go live with the core criminal case management. One of the other challenges has been around agreeing common approaches so that we get common standards and business processes that facilitate that. A great deal of progress has been made, but it's nonetheless a considerable challenge. And we have the huge challenge of working within the brownfield site that we currently have with a multiplicity of IT systems, all at different levels, with different business processes and different interfaces between those systems, which is presenting a huge challenge in trying to get to the level of consistency that we need to make this really work and be efficient as possible. We must all work together to achieve an effective and efficient but properly joined up system, because collectively we no longer have the resources to manage the inefficiency and failure demand or to implement workarounds that we have tolerated for years. And I think as part of that process, that level of joint working is going to be a challenge to us. All I'm seeing at the moment is huge willingness across the whole system to make that work, but we really have to focus on that. And that I think means that in some cases, in order to get to the place we need, we will have to give up some principles or practices that individual agencies have valued for years. And I think for me, the greatest thing, and most important thing, is that we keep our eyes on the prize, which is we can't afford not to deliver this. It's got to be total focus. Thank you.
Thank you very much. That's absolutely fantastic, thank you. Katy Bourne, please.
Okay, so good morning, everyone. So I've been given about a couple of hours, you said, Andrew? No, I'm just joking, just see if anyone's still awake. So just to bring it out of the sort of the strategic level and what does it mean for local people on the ground, I think that's why I'm probably here this morning to talk about the Southeast project that we've kicked off and that I'm leading on, but is actually a piece of work being done across all the agencies, all the criminal justice agencies in the Southeast. So I chair the Criminal Justice Board in Sussex, and obviously I'm the new kid on the block, welcomed with open arms, given copious amounts of chocolates. No, not at all. But for me, looking round the table at all the different criminal justice partners, I was overwhelmed almost by the diversity there and the different needs of each of the partners and the continual silo working. Despite the fact that everybody sitting around the table was saying, oh no, we do joint multi-working, we all collaborate together. And I hear a lot all the time about people saying this is all about the victims, this is all about the witnesses, but I never see anybody actually following through on that. So the frustration for me out there, you know, I'm elected to represent the public, I'm elected to represent those victims, those witnesses, those poor people that have to go through our criminal justice system without even a golden thread to hang on to help them on a seamless journey as they're buffered between different agencies. And that's even if they get through the system at the end of it, because we know many victims, many witnesses cannot even get through to the end of a simple court case. So I looked around and said, why is it taking so long for us to get from capture to conviction? Why is it taking so long for this process to happen? And how can we make it better? And what we've started to do in Sussex, we looked across, and I went to partners in Kent and the Metropolitan Police in London and with Surrey. And what we've proposed is nothing new. So we did, the initial part of our work was to scope, do we need something that's going to help us speed up the system through the courts? And then my background in business and having built and sold two companies, my experience is you start small, you prove the concept and you grow organically and you can make it bigger. But if you try and bite off too much of the elephant to start, you'll vomit and you'll never achieve what you want. So everyone was saying, well, we need this in courts and you need that in courts. And I said, no, we need to focus really small. So our plan, we did a scoping piece of work that said, should we be doing this? And the work came back and said, yes, we should, for all these reasons. The cost that it saves to all the agencies is quite astronomical year on year. And importantly, it helps the witness and the victim journey through the criminal justice system. So then we said, okay, let's really focus very, very small. So rather than looking across and saying, should we do Crown Court, should we do everything else? We said, no, let's just focus on the magistrates' courts, on those summary trials. And then let's just focus on those prisoners that are held in custody and those that are in remand. And I looked across at what our colleagues in Kent Police, have been doing for several years and were heralded as forerunners and were doing some great work. And they were doing this video link. So very simple, police officer, video linking in, giving justice straight into the magistrates' court through video. And it was heralded as the front runner, this is how everybody should be doing it and so on. So we went across to see what they were doing. And it was great in principle, but it didn't have the opportunity to scale up. And whilst it could have handled, it can handle the cases in Kent and probably could have taken on a neighbouring police force area, it could never have done anything nationally because the police were running this system themselves, not the courts, the police were doing this. And you'd have an officer would phone up the magistrates' court on the telephone and say, I'm ready to go. And the magistrates' court would say, so are we. And then they'd press the button to start the link, which kind of, to me, seemed a bit weird when you're talking about digitalising everything. Surely the people shouldn't actually be involved. The system should work without someone actually having to phone up and start it. So there was a delay there as well in that. So what we looked at, we said, was, well, these video links are really great ideas, and it is nothing new, but how do we do this on a volume that will make enough cases go through at speed? And then somebody else said to me, well, this has been trialled, I think it was Birmingham, where they did this, and they'd set aside about 5 minutes for every case to do a video link. And what had happened with that one, and why it had failed as far as I could see, was the fact that some of the offenders, when they realised that everybody was going to beam in on that first hearing, were going, OK, Gov, I'm guilty, it's a fair cop, rather than playing the system and saying I'm not guilty, knowing that the system would then take weeks, months, before they actually got to a hearing. And actually, by the time they got there, they'd probably, a lot of the victims or witnesses might have dropped out, and so they'd get off anyway. So instead of playing the system, they were putting their hands up and going for guilty. But what had happened was they were allowing about 5 minutes or 10 minutes per each of these video recordings. And of course, the offender was going in saying, I'm guilty straight off. And then everyone was sitting around for a few minutes twiddling their thumbs because they had this set system. So the whole thing was shown to be not economical because they'd allowed for a set time in the systems. So we kicked off a piece of work with a business partner and we said, actually, let's look across CPS, let's look across courts, and let's look across the police and see what money we can save and how many cases we could actually put through on a daily basis. And could we do this on a video link? And we showed that we could do probably 400 cases a day. 400 cases a day across the Met, Kent, Surrey and Sussex, once it's all up and running. Probably more than that. And this is just focus, don't forget, on those summary trials. So on the first remand hearing, on the first court hearing in a magistrate's court for a prisoner who's held in custody. Now, the other thing that came out of this was the fact that in Sussex, a police officer will spend about 5.5 hours on his or her shift giving evidence at court. Now, they're not standing there for 5.5 hours giving evidence, believe you me. The evidence that they give is probably about 30 minutes. So the remainder of the time is spent waiting for that case to arrive and come on. And when we did that across the Met, we found that their waiting times were about 4.5 hours. So we knew we were on the right track here. So 5.5 hours of a police officer's time is equivalent to a whole shift wasted. So for me, the saving for police was pretty obvious there. If we could put that video link into a police station, they can beam straight into court, they can carry on their work, and when they need to, they're already there anyway and they can give evidence. So the second part of our programme put 26 endpoints across Sussex in all the police stations. Kent already has them, Sussex needed them, Surrey doesn't have them yet, but they're in the end bit of our programme, and the Met need to do this as well because they're closing a lot of their custody centres and they need this availability. So we put the video links in and we've just started officers now giving evidence direct into just those magistrates' first hearings, focusing it really small. And then we've also put a couple of the end links in the mental health hospitals as well, so to allow high-risk people with mental health crisis who are clearly on remand, allow them to give evidence straight in instead of them having to get into a van and be transported to a court, which is an incredibly traumatic experience for anybody, let alone somebody who's got mental health problems. And it's really having some great results because obviously it's allowing police officer time to be freed up and so on. Now, I have to say the third part of it now is we're applying to the Police Reform Transformation Board to do this across the four force areas. And for me, we are focusing small and we are linked in now with courts and with CPS and into the National Common Platform Programme as well. So we don't want to be doing anything that is going to stop a national programme from happening. But the big thing, and what I'm saying to everybody, is yes, there are wins financially for all of us here. Yes, there are wins in time for all of us here. But the biggest win, I think, is for members of the public, for the victims and witnesses, potentially. And the other big win is the fact that for the first time ever, criminal justice agencies across four police force areas will be working together. That, in 18 months, I think is one heck of an achievement. Now, it hasn't started yet, and we are waiting for the final part of funding to come through. But the signs look good. The will is there. We have national support, and we are very much linked in. So we're not going to be doing anything that is going to stop anything that's nationally in flight or about to happen. And we will make mistakes. We will get it wrong. But we'll get it wrong small, because we're focused very small. And as we make those mistakes, we can correct them and we will get better. And then hopefully we will have a blueprint should this wish to be taken into other regions. So that gives you a very quick run through of where we are with the Southeast Video Enabled Justice Programme, or as I like to call it, the VEG Programme, because it's easier for me to remember. Thank you.
Katy, wonderful. And our final panellist, Jason Hall, please.
Thank you, Andrew. Good morning, everybody. So I wanted to talk to, I'll build on the theme that I mentioned earlier in the introduction, which is around connecting people and looking at the whole system of justice. And I think Lord Leveson, in his review, and Bryan referred to that earlier, was it came back, and it's reported that obviously the criminal justice system needs modernisation, but the criminal justice system is a really complex system. And the only way that we can transform this system is by organisations and participants working together, having common processes, having access to the right systems, having access to the right information. And this puts me in an interesting position as an IT provider, because traditionally we've seen lots of organisations developing systems based on their own processes, on their own requirements, and without that level of interoperability and that interconnectivity between the organisations that a really effective and an efficient justice system actually needs. However, you know, that was at the time was the only way that really IT could be delivered. That was the system and the way the system operated. But I think since then, things have moved on. And as IT providers, we've worked very hard with government and the public sector to start to develop standards so information can be shared more effectively. One standard that I was involved in was the Public Services Network, the PSN network, which had common standards for network connectivity right across the whole of government, enabling information sharing and infrastructure to work effectively. And so, as a result of these initiatives, I think IT now is no longer the barrier. And as we move to cloud-based services, we move to the internet, I think we're seeing a greater standardisation of how applications and services are built. And that presents a tremendous opportunity for the criminal justice system as a whole. And so if we look at other examples and other industries where this technology has been applied, I've got a couple of examples here that BT as an organisation has been involved in. And so if we look at the finance and insurance systems as a system rather than the information technology itself, technology and automation has enabled faster decision making on loans and people's credit worthiness, and that is a streamlined process now, and there's no reason why that kind of technology couldn't be brought into the court system for assessing fines, for example. And also, the insurers have formed a system as well to start to prevent fraud. So by interconnecting and sharing information, that starts to give new insight on the participants in that whole system, that whole business system, and starts to generate efficiencies, savings, and benefits for all. And another system, which is something that everybody, it touches everybody in this room, is the health system. And if we look at how the system operates, everybody enters and exits that system at various points along a journey. And that journey is under increasing financial scrutiny, it's under scrutiny from the public and from other reviewers as well. And I think that health system has got a lot of similarities with the criminal justice system in the way that it operates and the number of participants and the number of entry and exit points into that system as well. And I just want to give just a couple of examples here just to bring this to life. So BT's worked with Islington CCG and the Borough Council to put an interoperability system into that region. And that system has enabled 200,000 patient records to be accessed by 10,000 healthcare and social care professionals. So they can access the information when they need it, where they need it, to enable faster decision making and enable better outcomes for the patients and the participants in that system. And so that's a real life example of how this has been brought together. If I look at the other end of the spectrum, if I look at the policing end of the spectrum and the system, we've been working very closely with four forces, bringing together Surrey, Sussex, Hampshire and Thames Valley on a single platform, on a single framework to have common services, to enable these efficiencies to be brought together and start to have this commonality of approach, process and mindset. And I think this, you know, these initiatives, this interoperability, this sharing information, that really does unlock new savings and new benefits. And then if I start to take those examples and put them specifically into a criminal justice system and start to think through how that would work, I start to look at the actors or the participants in that system. So, you know, if you look at the police officer on the beat, if they're connected, you know, they're talking to a potential suspect, they could have the healthcare information for that suspect available, the mental health care as well, information available about that suspect, because quite often that is involved or a factor in any offending activity. Also, another great opportunity for efficiency is to be able to capture that information, the officer to put that information into a device without having to return to base, still be out there, out on the beat, working effectively, and putting that information into a single common evidence package or evidence file that can then be shared with the CPS. And, you know, that interaction between the police and the CPS, as we discussed earlier, you know, that's a key interaction in the criminal justice system. And we talked about the common platform, and that yields great benefits. And interoperability and sharing of information on that platform in a similar way to the way that the health systems work, you know, would be hugely beneficial to the overall criminal justice system. And Katy, you mentioned earlier about bringing participants together, using technology, using collaboration tools to be able to make decisions quickly without people having to travel and having to leave their office as well. And that leads to more likelihood of the right plea from the accused, or the right outcome for the victim. And if we finally look at the prisons and probation service, quite often they are dealing with some of the most challenging people in our society. And by having the right information available, it enables the right interventions to be made. Is that education? Be that health? And really the whole objective of those interventions is to reduce reoffending and to enable people to re-enter the community. So I believe that technology can be a real enabler for improving the criminal justice system. And we have an opportunity to create a criminal justice system that is fit and proper for the 21st century. But do we have the ambition to build a criminal justice system that is a benchmark and the envy of the world? Thank you very much.
Well, I feel rather inspired after hearing our four speakers, because the sense of the possibility and the sense of the commitment to making these changes is very real, which I think genuinely is rather inspiring, as I say. So is the need for change, and I think most of our speakers touched on some of the very sort of practical kind of waste of time and effort that's involved in not having these digital processes. Waste of police officer time, poor organisation of the courts. You know, we could go on. We've heard that, Paul. I thought you and people picked up on the Twitter, as you said. You know, in today's world, even if we wanted to, we can't afford to do failure demand, was your word, you know, so the problems we create for ourselves. Why are we doing these workarounds? You know, it's time to cut through that. So I thought that was very well made. And then taking some of the points that struck out most to me, Bryan, and I think also Jason made the point that there are standards. I mean, Bryan, you sort of said, look, the World Wide Web is a very good standard, right? We all use it, everyone uses it. You know, here we are, that's, you know, if we talk about interoperability. So we have a sense that there are standards available. We talked a lot about minimum viable products. Bryan did, Katy did, Paul did. I think that raises the question of, how do those things grow into, what's the opposite of a maximum viable product? So it's something which, you know, genuinely does start to pull it all together. And Katy, you were saying that, you know, you were trying to design your system in a way that could become kind of a blueprint for something more national. Okay, well, that's what we've got to do. So how does that work? And then perhaps to finish on Paul's point, nevertheless, none of this is easy. Otherwise, we would all be here. None of us, rather, would be here. Yeah, there are legacy systems, so that always causes a question. And you know, we are going to do things differently. And this is a classic reform think tank point. Things are going to have to change. Some things are going to have to stop. So there's an organisation and even perhaps sometimes a political challenge about that as well. I would just like to spend half an hour, taking the optimistic thoughts from there. How are we going to take this forward? If there are challenges, we've identified some. How are we going to break them down? Let's open it up. So can I take two or three questions and points together, and I'll bring them to the panel. So we'll come over here first, please. So we've got one and two, and then three, madam. Do you want to just say who you are, sir? And then...
John Patience, I'm the chief executive of the Nehemiah Project. We're a small charity that works with men coming out of prison who've had addictions. So I guess my interest was just really in to what extent you've considered the fact that most of the people in the criminal justice system are probably the least IT literate that you can find. So to what extent are you designing systems around sort of benefits to the bigger system, but you know, to what extent have you considered some of the challenges that might pose for the people who are actually caught up in the system?
Thank you. We'll come forward with this one row, please.
Penelope Gibbs from Transform Justice here.
Thank you. I'd
like to talk about virtual courts, and the only good study we have is from 2010 and an MOJ evaluation of them. And that suggested that those defendants who appeared virtually got more punitive sentences for similar crimes, right, and that there was a much higher level of defendants without lawyers, which is, I think we would all agree, not a very great development in the criminal justice system. We've had no evaluation since 2010. How does the panel think we should track, monitor, prevent those problems?
Thank you very much indeed. And then we'll come over. There, just wave your hand in the air. There we are. Thanks, Ruby. Please.
Hi, Jo Easton from the Magistrates Association. Two quick questions, if that's okay.
Yeah.
First of all, Katy, I just wasn't sure whether your program's aimed at first bail hearings or whether it is actually people on remand and therefore second or third hearings. And then the second question was, Paul, you mentioned that agencies might have to give up on principles or practices that they hold dear.
Yeah.
Have you got any examples of those?
Thank you. Very, very, very good questions. We'll go in the same order. So we'll start with Katy and come down. Just on that first question, digital literacy is a great thought.
Yeah.
That question was about offenders. Do you also want to talk about the wider, we're talking about staff here, we're talking about police officers, let's talk about the professionals as well. Go,
yeah,
please.
You're absolutely right. Offenders are probably the least literate when it comes to digital. So if they're on a first hearing, they wouldn't be on their own anyway. And so that mm-hmm. kind of wouldn't happen there. But if we look at the actual, do we as members of the public, I think, I don't know what the exact sums are, but sort of 8 to 10% still don't go online. And in Sussex, when I look across our elderly population, which we have a very high percentage in the east of the county, I think 24% of our population is over the age of 65. which goes against the national average of about 17%. And a lot of the much more elderly don't use digital at all, so they can't connect with the public. I've often said I think people in their 80s who aren't connected are probably now more alone than they've ever been in a community because they cannot get online and find out the opening times of a library, and people don't put posters up like they used to. We don't use newsletters and physical like we used to. And it's the same for officers as well. So, you know, officers themselves need to understand how digital works when they're doing a lot of the investigations. If they go in and they're going into a house for a burglary and they're carrying two or three different digital items, that will automatically link into the Wi-Fi or the local area network. And you actually might have the perpetrator, the burglar, might actually have already connected as well. And if an officer turns up and it gets knocked off, so you've lost vital evidence. So you need officers to understand basic, have a basic understanding digitally, but it is really important. We can't assume that everybody gets it. But we do have a generation now, younger generation, and this is as normal to them as breathing is to all of us. Mm-hmm. And they use technology in a way that we can't even imagine. So things we take for granted, like meeting people for the first time physically, they do it online. They don't, and they think nothing of it. So it's an interesting world that we're moving into. And criminals are eons ahead of us. They're capitalising. You know, we talked about a 19th century process, criminal justice process, 20th century policing model, 21st century criminals capitalising and industrialising crime through fraud and cyber and that. And we've got 5.5 million new crimes now recorded because of this. So, yeah, interesting time we live in.
And do you want to comment on the question on virtual courts? So that's a very interesting thought, that the style of organisation of justice may actually start to have an influence on, well, it's two things really. What does it have an influence on decisions, but also how do we evaluate these changes which we're making?
Yes, I mean, you know, the great thing about our court process is that you are innocent until you're proven guilty, and I think that's really important that we hang on to that as much as we can. So, you know, whatever process we move into, we need to ensure that the person who isn't guilty, they're not guilty until they're proven that way, you know, that they're given that justice as well. And there will always be the need for the looking in the whites of the eyes and sitting there and physically seeing a person in a court. There will always be that. But as we move on with digital, you know, a lot of the cases now, speeding and so on, can be done online. And I think people are happy with that as well. They'd much rather just, you know, get on with it, pay a fine and move on with their lives. I think the lady there asked about the hearings. Yep. It is only the first hearing, so the first one that we're focused on. As I said, we're small, focus small, and then, you know, as we move on, we can hopefully adapt and see.
Thank you. Bryan, do you want to deal with these questions?
Yes.
You can remember them.
Yes, I do. I mean, I think the first thing about, you know, literacy and numeracy and how easy is it to use systems, you know, in a prison putting in services, one of the products that we've been deploying recently is a thing called prisoner self-service, where we take the administrative burden that's currently with the prison officer and we give that to the prisoner. So they have to do the routine admin tasks themselves, like booking visits, working out what sort of meals they're going to have. Tremendous savings, very positive benefits in terms of behaviour and academic evidence to show that we should expect that to impact reoffending rates in a good way. If people can't read very easily, it's quite hard to get them to do that. But actually, in reality, with a carefully designed interface that's that uses graphics, that's entirely feasible. We're seeing that working, and people helping each other. It's something we can overcome. In terms of evidence of what works, I do think that's absolutely critical. to getting this process right. It's often something that one, in one's enthusiasm to make changes, it's often mm-hmm. something that one tends to do after the event, which is rather too late because the evidence isn't there. So we're being very careful to baseline mm-hmm. what we're doing, mm-hmm. and also using some quite sophisticated statistics in order to be able to compare mm-hmm. with and without the change right. in quite a sophisticated way, and using independent third yep. parties to oversee that, because yep. In my enthusiasm I would say that it was great anyway, but it's nice to have that yep. that independent verification. I think the other point which is which I think was raised, which is in terms of scalability. Well, if you ever go and see any venture capitalist, that's all they want to talk about before they give you the money, is how you're going to scale. Mm-hmm. Yeah, the reality of it is that if you get your product right mm-hmm. and you base the technology on the right platform, the scale can be achieved remarkably quickly. It's all about getting it right and then scaling. So, by way of example, I said that we're working in two prisons at the moment on yeah. in-cell technology. But I think we've just about got that right. And we're ready to scale. Mm-hmm. And so within the next 12 months, I anticipate that to be deployed across 21 prisons.
Yeah.
And, that's going to be almost a third of the estate. So it's about getting it right and then scaling. That's what I would say.
Okay. Thank you very much. This is a very important point. Paul, please.
If I can pick up the... I've been racking my brain just to find a good example to give you of where something dearly held has been given up. I think the best one I can give you just at the moment is that the importance of holding public hearings, of courts sitting in public, with magistrates dealing with cases in the courtroom, and how that principle has now changed into the ability to deal with straightforward, simple, summary-only cases online. So mm-hmm. we've taken that completely out of the courtroom, and that's an example of where something that would have one time have been considered to be vitally important, that this yep. is done in a courtroom with all the solemnity of the court process.
Yep.
Now it's online process, and not quite like buying something from Amazon, but it's that slick. But it will be accompanied by the necessary transparency to ensure that the listing of cases and the results of cases is available, so that the information that a member of the public would have got if they'd gone into that courtroom is still accessible.
Yep.
And
yep.
that's important, how we actually modernise our concepts of how we work.
Yeah.
I think that the other question, Brian's touched on quite a lot of this about accessibility for users. I think that's absolutely essential. Mm. We're working very closely with the Ministry of Justice to ensure that we've got assisted digital processes for people who really can't
yep.
Interact yep. with the system. But I think the other thing is, it's the importance of design, of the yep. screen design, and also of actually proper, thorough user research. And by that, I don't just mean with the professionals in the criminal justice system. It has to be with all the users. So an example of that in Manchester, yep. where we launched the first online police screens, we did quite a lot of user research there with the defendants who would actually use those screens to enter their pleas in motoring cases. We designed those screens so that they were mm-hmm. really clear and easy to use. Mm-hmm. And we conducted user research after we'd gone live with them. And actually, one of the things we noticed is that the number of people who were using the screens and entering pleas was much greater than had previously been the case with the paper-based process.
Right.
And actually, we also noticed that there was an increase of guilty pleas proportionately.
Right.
And we conducted further user research, and the feedback we got was that the screens were actually much clearer to follow than the wadge of papers people were previously getting with different forms and different explanations. And it made it very clear what their rights were, as well as what they were required to do, and what they they had to do if they wanted to have a court hearing, and what they could do if they wanted the case to be dealt with in their absence. The last figures I saw, over 50,000 people have used those screens to enter guilty pleas. Yep. So I think there is a real appetite out there, and it's a question of getting the design right, but at the same time we do recognise that there are people who will not be able to interact with a fully digital system, and we need to provide some support for them.
Yeah. I mean not to interrupt, but I mean, in most of our lives, communication on these things is easy, right? I mean, we mentioned Amazon, other complex things we do like banking, it has just become easier because of these processes, not harder. So anyway, there we are. Jason, sorry.
Yeah, so I'll go through the questions in the order they were posed. So I think in terms of the IT literacy, I think there's a couple of dimensions to that. I think the first is that the pace in which digital change is occurring in our society. I think if you're in an institution of some form and you don't have access to that, you can even though you may be tech literate when you go in, you can be left behind quite quickly during that journey, which gives you a disadvantage when you come back to re-enter into the community. I think as society changes, I mean, we've got some statistics where 80% of the adult population have smartphones and access the internet through those smartphones. So it is becoming a more pervasive technology. So as you said, our defaults should be looking at digital, how we can digitally enable processes in cell, on the wing, the self-service, giving more control to the prisoners over their specific environment and things that they want to consume in the prison. So I think that's one of the ways in which we can look at technology. I think one of the other challenges as well is some of the prisoners are very IT literate and do have access to contraband devices, etc. And I think that's a big challenge, stopping that type of activity. Mm-hmm. So there's a number of different facets here. So it's a very fine line between enablement and control. Mm-hmm. And I think all of us in the system have been thinking very hard about that problem and challenge. The second question was around the virtual courts. And from a technology provider perspective, I think there's a couple of things to think about here. The advance in big data and analytics, and that was actually our last reform event, that should be a source of capability and resource to enable review of some of these cases and look at the differences and the variations from other course methods and methodologies. And it could give insight into how these processes run. I think one of the other things to think about is, certainly within BT, we do lots of training around unconscious bias, and we do lots of training around that, and it's an area of new expertise. And I think that may be another resource to draw upon as part of implementing change. It's not just an IT change, it's a cultural change as well, and that may be an area to look at. And lastly, in terms of what things would people give up, we've implemented the Wi-Fi, the court's Wi-Fi project across the court's estate. And one thing that struck me was the ability or the willingness to actually give up a standalone information assurance policy or approach and adopt the verify.gov, which is a standardised access information assurance and access control. Mm-hmm. So we can see that the standardisation, they're giving up a small element of control and moving to another approach, which again is accredited and joins up the criminal justice system. Is a step in the right direction, enabling information to be shared.
Thank you. That is really excellent. Let's take one more round of questions. I have to say, listening to us talking, this all sounds perhaps not easy. It definitely sounds like it's going to happen. Yeah. So I've just got remaining questions about, well, how fast? Are we leaving any bit of the system out? I don't think we've mentioned probation here. Maybe that's just happened by accident. Maybe we can challenge our panel a bit. So we've got a couple of questions. We've got loads of questions, right? I'll take probably four or five short questions, please, and then that'll be at the close of this session. So please, that's it, and then we'll come to Charlie.
Hi, Beth Murray from Catch 22. We run work across prisons, offender management and resettlement across about a third of the estate, and we're very lucky to be able to run lots of victim services all around the UK for different police and crime commissioners. My question is around using technology to enable relationships. It's really clear from our services that the one defining factor in a good outcome for a victim or for an offender is the quality of the relationship that they're able to have. So my question is around how do we make sure that technology enables relationships rather than replaces relationships throughout that journey?
Sorry, do you mean relationships between who? Sorry, can I ask?
So it's the relationship, for instance, between a prison officer and somebody in a cell. It might be the relationship between somebody who is taking somebody into court for the first time, or it might be even the relationship for a victim who's going through the victim's process to have someone to turn to.
So support. Thank you. Do you want to bring it to the front row, Ruby? Thank you. And then, actually, can we please pass it? Otherwise, Ruby's got to clamber over about four rows. That's it. Thank you very much.
So, really, is that on? Yeah.
That's on.
So, a really quick question. What is the one single biggest barrier that each of you think is facing this sort of digital transformation?
Great question. We'll keep part. Yeah, we'll.
Good morning. Dr. Angela Lennox, Head of Clinical Governance for G4S. I'm really interested in what you've said. My interest is in health and health risks and managing those risks. And so I want to ramp up a gear and ask you, how are you going to move forward with this so that it enables me and all the professionally registered staff that I'm responsible for to safely share health information that will ultimately benefit the individual and their families?
Thank you, I might not be able to get everybody in because we ran out of time.
Hello, it's David Munro, Police and Crime Commissioner for Surrey. One other group hasn't been mentioned so far, I think, and that's the judiciary, and I include magistrates and coroners in that. I think their appetite for this is patchy, in my view. Some are certainly up for it. Some are much more interested, overly interested, in outcome, i.e. they are obsessed with getting the right guilty, not guilty outcome, rather than process of getting people through this justice system. That may mean having to cut corners. Some of them would not agree with that, but I'd be interested to see what the panel would think.
Thank you. Okay, these are excellent questions. So I'll go the other way around this time, starting with Jason. So we've got two questions on kind of opportunities, technology to actually support relationships and then bring the health dimension, the health data, which is a question actually I was going to ask. And then two questions on barriers. Charlie's, what's the one thing that's got to change? And then is the judiciary on side here?
Okay. So I'll take them in order. So in terms of technology to enable relationships, I think with the advent of social media and how most of us interact with families that maybe across the world, I think lots of us are very familiar with that type of technology. I think the thing I would think about is, where do we put or invest in that quality of the relationship? And by quality, I mean the richness of interaction. So in the way we work in BT, as an example, we would quite often have face-to-face kickoffs. We would build that rapport. We would get to know the people we were working with and build that relationship. And then as we were going through in terms of the follow-ups, we would quite often do a check-in via using the technology for that type of approach. So that's how I see this working going forwards potentially. If you took a healthcare scenario, obviously a healthcare professional will want to assess a prisoner or someone in custody. They will want to work through that. But if there's a period of counselling, etc., we've seen some pilots being done in the US where that's done by a video link as an ongoing process. So it's really blending this type of technology into the overall package of care and interaction is really, really key. I sort of covered the health piece, and I think I talk about interoperability. I think that's there, and I think it's looking very hard at that again and looking how that information can be shared across the information assurance boundaries as well. And I think it's looking at how that can those policies can be amended if they need to be to help share health information. So the single barrier,
From an IT provider perspective, I think one of the greatest challenges is to be able to get the information we need out of the legacy systems and being able to use that in a new way to have new outcomes. I think if we look at, so again, coming back to security, you have huge masses of data in legacy systems, all locked away, all treated with the same. So whatever the highest level of security is on that one piece of data, that's applied to the overall content in that file. And I think it's breaking through that, releasing that information that's currently there, reviewing how we can share, what's the criticality of this information. I think that's one of the biggest barriers, but also biggest opportunity for unlocking this system. And the last point was on the judiciary. Mm-hmm. It's a very interesting question. You see, there's a huge spectrum, I think, of the judiciary. I think some of them are very tech savvy, really get what the benefits of technology, and really want to adopt it, and they can't adopt it fast enough. I think there's others who say, "No, I've been used to my modus operandi for a number of years." I think, frankly, that's the same with every change project. And I think it's about change leadership within the judiciary. And I think that's probably where the area of focus would need to be to unlock that potential barrier going forwards.
Thank you very much indeed. Paul, please.
OK. I'll pick up with that judicial point as well, actually, if I may. We the senior presiding judge sits on the Common Platform Programme Board. He's very active and hugely supportive, and the contribution and support we've had from all the senior judiciary, the Lord Chief, and Brian Leveson, who's already been mentioned, has been very, very strong, and they are very enthusiastic to embrace the possibilities. And I've seen that right across the whole spectrum of the judiciary. We have a district judge that sits on the design authority for the Common Platform Programme, and he's very immersed in that level of business process and working very closely with us. And the other level of the spectrum, I have met members of the judiciary who have been really concerned about the introduction of new technologies and how that they would be able to use them. And one particular recorder that I know quite well was really concerned about that. However, when the digital case system was introduced in that particular court centre, he's embraced it with immense enthusiasm. And the local practitioners have hugely welcomed the really proactive way that he's used that system and taken to it with great ease. So I think inevitably, as Jason said, there will be people who are reluctant and hesitant, but I think providing them with good tools that are well designed and that are easy to use is the key to that. But also keeping them engaged and consulted and involved in the process of the design and the sign off is also important. Yep. If I can move on to the question about personal relationships, because I think that's really important. Mm-hmm. We mustn't lose sight of the fact that actually the criminal justice system is about people. It's a people-based process. And human interaction within that process is are vital. The relationship between the prosecutor and the investigating police officer, between the witness care officer and the victim and witness, between the prison officer and the offender, between the probation officer and the offender. They are key parts, and actually it's those relationships that make the process work effectively. And really what we're setting out to do is to give those professionals the information they need in the most usable form, quickly and easily accessible, to ensure that instead of spending time in what is effectively administrative work trying to manage that information, they can access it easily and concentrate their efforts in that human interaction. And I think that's really important.
Sorry, I was going to really give us your single barrier that must be torn down.
Well, I think the one challenge that we do face actually is around budgets and funding, because what we have to do to make this all work effectively is coordinate our activity, and that is not easy with the funding constraints and the way funding is managed across government and government projects. So I think that's something that we have to work really hard at.
So are you saying there, form, we're always interested in the money. Are you saying that there isn't enough money, or are you saying that because the money is dispersed between different places, that's makes it a bit exhausting to try and get everybody together?
It's both of those, but it's also the money might be available in one agency at one point in time, but not at the same time in another agency, and when they need to do something critical to facilitate. That I think is probably the biggest challenge.
Right. But, and is this an insurmountable challenge, or one that can be?
Well, I don't think it's insurmountable, but I think it takes a lot of work to actually manage that.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you, Bryan. Please.
Well, I'm just thinking. Can you tear down the biggest single barrier that I'm facing in the work that my team are doing? Well, definitely not, because it's really steel bars and thick walls are the biggest single issue that we have in putting technology into prisons. Right. And we're not planning to remove them. It's actually nearly two-thirds of the cost of digitising a prison. It has to be for the mundane task of putting copper cables in. However, having done that, a lot more is possible. Mm-hmm. So that's the biggest single challenge. I think relationships is a really important question, and I think that operates on different levels. The ability for an individual to stay in contact with people who are supporting them through the system, certainly in prisons, is a particularly important thing. And I mentioned, making telephony more accessible. I mean, that in itself makes a tremendous difference. But that can extend to other means of communications. Controlled access to emails is potentially very powerful. Yeah. Exchanging messages with families, very powerful indeed. The other piece that we haven't done yet, but I can tell you we started the designs for it, is the sudden realization that using internet technology to people in the system creates not just the automation of process, but it creates a digital channel to communicate with the individual. Mm-hmm. And as soon as you get your head around that idea and realize that channel can be used by multiple agencies, and that content can be tailored to the individual, to where they are in the, if you were operating a large enterprise, trying to communicate with your customers, and I'm sure BT understand all about that. That digital channel would be in this day and age central to your business. Well, I think we need to get our thoughts around how we can use such a channel to bring in multiple people into direct communication with the individual. I think the other point that was raised was, where are we in relation to probation?
Yes.
Well, I think the reality is that probation has really suffered over the past few years for in technology in investment. However, I can say that we're now drawing our attention significantly to that. There's a lot of basics that need to be put in place just to give people access to technology that's reliable, very basic stuff. And that's happening. Taking legacy systems and making them more usable is a process that's actively happening. I was in Sheffield yesterday in the studio where we're working on that, and just looking at a lot of the new products that are coming into that space very soon. I think the very interesting area that in NOMS, where we're making a huge commitment in the next 12 months, is to reinforce the workforce by bringing additional staff into play who will work directly with offenders.
Yeah.
And we have an ambition to spend so many minutes each week with each offender, and that management process should straddle the gate to the prison. and technology to support that, and the, you know, the challenge to you know, simple thing of sharing case notes between the prison and the mm-hmm. probation service. Well, it's possible, and we're doing it. But that's you know, that's a okay. that's the next step.
Thank you. We'll talk more about this in our next panel, of course. Katy, please.
Yes, so trying to remember all the different questions. So picking up on the victims piece, really important for victims, young children and adults who've been, say, victims of serious sexual offence to be able to give evidence and to be able to give it in a secure environment that's not necessarily a police station or a courtroom, absolutely vital. So I think that's where certainly... electronic means and that allow that to happen, really, really important. And we're doing quite a bit of work around victims in Sussex. You know, how do we make sure that the service we provide is what they want? So we're using technology to do that now, and we're looking at how we can improve that going forward. And then the lady from the health, you said, how do we get health to talk? Oh my word. okay, so let me just give you a local example. So I went to see a CCG recently, a clinical commissioning group, and they said to me, we're building this great new system and we're going to be able to share information. And I said, well, that's great. Does it talk to the police? Does it talk to, you know, the Marocks? Does it talk to other? Oh no. Well, we can't do that because of data protection. So how about we have a data sharing act with protections, rather than a data protection act that prevents anyone from sharing anything? And I think, you know, for me, if you look at what happened in the investment banking world back in the early 90s, they had a protocol called FIX, which allows real-time dissemination of information across secure mm-hmm. networks. Really, really sensitive stuff. And they set a protocol up, and so everybody now uses that protocol. That's what we need across the criminal justice system. So we can build as many systems as we like, but we all speak the same language. We have a standard language that we can all use. So then it doesn't really matter. We can have all our different systems. And Charlie's question, what's the one biggest blocker? I'm going to be really, really controversial here. It's both a blocker and our greatest opportunity, people. It's people. Because you meet people like the ones on the panel who have a real will to make a change. And a desire to do it. And then you meet others who just want business as usual. They want to stay in their world. They don't want the change. So I think people are our biggest blocker and our biggest opportunity as well.
Thank you. That's a great way to end. I've gone over a couple of minutes. I apologise for that. I thought that was an extremely impressive panel. I remember actually when Ben Gummer launched the government's digital transformation strategy with us earlier in the year, the example he used of progress was a justice example. He talks about prisons. I wonder if there's a sense that this area of policy is ahead. I do think, for what it's worth, if we'd had a health panel, we wouldn't have been able to talk to about as much progress as we have done here. So there's a sense of real progress. There's a sense of results. There's a commitment to evaluate, which I think is really important. What do we need to get better? We are going to make better use of our legacy data. Perhaps a question, but still, that's what we're going to do. We are going to keep going through the exhausting process of getting organisations to work together, realise what's in the benefit of one to the other and all the rest of it. There is a cost here, so we're going to keep making the service more efficient because I guess that will provide the resources that allow new investment. We are going to find the single common language, although we talked about common standards, but there's still that need. And perhaps then we've got at the end there to the real issue, Katy, which is we're going to build a new generation of staff and leaders who are going to be as committed as these four people. So I think that's incredibly helpful. I just want to thank everyone for their comments and for those contributions. Let me hand over to Charlie Pickles, who will chair the second panel. And as I do that, let's thank this panel. Thank you very much. Thank you.